attack on health workers. And you saw that earlier in Bangalore where ASHA workers were attacked. You've been seeing that in Indore, and now recently, yesterday, you saw that happening in Moradabad as well in Uttar Pradesh. What's the cause of this? How is it that mobs are gathering and able to sort of attack these health workers who are just coming there to take patients to quarantine centers? Harsha, just to begin, can you please lay out the facts of what happened in Moradabad?
Yeah, see, if we go by what the doctor who's been injured in this attack has to say. So he says they went to Nawabpura in Moradabad to take four men to the quarantine facility because they were from the family of the COVID-19 victim. But as soon as they sat in the ambulance, some people gathered, a ruckus ensued, and then people started attacking them, and only some elderly man intervened. So this doctor was saved, and but the police had to intervene, and people were pelting stones on the police also. So a mob, and as per recent reports, they're saying there was news of a possible attempt by authorities to take people in certain localities to what is being called things like a detention camp. So that is what has ensued, and this is the latest of the incidents on the health workers.
Right. Tushar, this is not an isolated case. We are seeing this in a number of places where health workers are being attacked. And there is often this thread of a fear of maybe people are coming in for registering for NRC or fear of being taken into a detention camp. Where are these fears emanating from?
Absolutely, Karan. This is not a stray incident. It's not normally. It's becoming a chain of events. Now it's becoming a routine rather. Now the thing is, if the mob is attacking police or health workers in any part of India, it signifies a complete breakdown of law and order. This is a very, very serious matter. You cannot have a complete breakdown of law and order where the police is under attack from the mob just because they're doing their duty in this very critical hour. First thing. Second thing, tomorrow, if we have to, if workers, government workers have to go for the work of NPR or sometime in the future for NRC, are they going to be pelted with stones wherever they go, especially if the demographics of Moradabad are taken into account?
That has already happened, Tushar. Karan was saying, the ASHA worker who has gone there to collect details of in a locality has been called as someone who's collecting data for NCR, and that is why people attacked her. And in her own words, she said there were prayer centers which were giving out calls saying do not give out information to health workers. And this lady was brutally attacked. Her bag was stolen. Taken away, and she was traumatized by what has happened because most of these people were told she was there to collect NRC data.
Harsha and Tushar, I want you to pitch in on these two dimensions that I'm seeing. One is, of course, the fact that this template has been set over the last few months. Now, if you go back, 6 to 8 months, you saw protests in Delhi, the Shaheen Bagh protests that you saw, even when there were advisories out there that said that you can't have a congregation of more than 50 people, protesters still continued to sit there and sort of have this anti-government sentiment. Is there something missing there? Because
Karan, I'd like to what Harsha just said. It's not only about the community there. It's also about putting women and children forward. As we saw in Shaheen Bagh, women and children were made on the forefront of the movement. So it complicates the work of the law enforcement agencies as well. You put women in front and suddenly you take an action against any one woman. It becomes a subject of intolerance. It becomes the state is being called brutal just because it's performs its duty. Yesterday, according to some drone shots that were taken by the UP police, you could see women on the terraces pelting stones on the health workers. Now, as Harsha said, one very genuine question is, where do they find all these stones? And how come it's that all of them have stones just at the right time, just when a healthcare worker is in there to do their duty? These are some very important questions. They might sound a little foolish to a person covering this issue, but where are these stones coming from? If I were to go out in my society right now, I wouldn't find stones to pelt at anyone. Where are the stones coming up? Who is backing them? Where is the assurance that you can go around breaking law and order and there won't be any action against you? There needs to be this question asked that who is backing these people? who is inciting the violence, and where are the rumors originating from?
Right. I also feel like over the months, what's changed is you had people rallying against the government, right? Now, there is something entirely different from the government that you're battling.
Yes.
But the status is such that now you're still rallying against the government, even though they are on your side, to be frank, in this fight against coronavirus, isn't that?
So the government is working for the people. Any one case of community transmission in a densely populated area, irrespective of the community, could jeopardize that life of the community for the next 1 month. That's what the government is trying to do, sending in healthcare workers, sending some test kits, sending some police along. The police should be right now deployed in controlling that the essentials reach people at the right time, in the right manner. But instead, they are safeguarding our healthcare workers. In any sane society, healthcare workers shouldn't be pelted. Though in any sane society, no one should be pelting stones. But right now, at the juncture we are in, fighting a virus outbreak which has 2 million cases across the globe, the last thing you would want is your health workers being pelted with stones.
Absolutely. These kind of incidents are defying sense, defying science, and defying society. Why else would you want to pelt stones at somebody who is trying to ensure there's no break of a pandemic? Like, for example, that quarantine, the COVID patient's family that they were taking, if the health workers didn't intervene there, that was an entire area which could have got the virus, right? So here is a system trying to keep you safe, and you are pelting stones at that very system. So why is this happening? Like, what explains this kind of activity? And you cannot be calling it anti-government. It is plain anti-sense and anti-science.
Harsha, you're talking about what is spurring this on. And I think one of the things that we need to look at is also media narratives and selectivity and bias in coverage of different incidents. How much of that do you guys think has played a role here?
Oh, absolutely. Highlighting the events and the selective reportage, selective highlighting, like even whether it was even yesterday's the migrant episode in Bandra, now the media is being held accountable. But the sensationalization and selective reportage is doing a lot of damage. And how are selective information being channelized and made to sound you're making the entire area vulnerable by highlighting these incidents, and this should be the first thing that should be checked. I think the virus is more is less deadly than these sources of information who are almost creating an infodemic. One of the WHO persons had recently spoken about calling it an infodemic. This infodemic is doing much more damage than the virus because it's making people more prone to the virus. I think that's where also the system needs to take charge in some sense.
Karan, to add what Harsha just said, we also need to looking at decisive action. Every time an incident like this happens, it happened in Delhi when there were riots, police was pelted with stones. It happened in Indore a week ago. It happened yesterday in Moradabad. And looking at the chain of events, we might have something similar happening next week. I think it's time we look at a surveillance mechanism similar to employed in China. It's not a good thing to have, but if these incidents are going to go on forever, the state needs to think of some decisive action. Any writer, as the Yogi government has done in Uttar Pradesh, one, make their names public, to make sure they are not a part of any government welfare scheme. These should be some suggestions that should be taken up. If people cannot be trusted to follow the law and order, the state has to take some decisive action, or else you're going to have these problems stretching along. Because every one incident like this, which goes unpunished, though the Yogi government has arrested 10 people, but any one mob incident that goes unpunished inspires 10 other such incidents for the future. So we need to start looking at some decisive action by the state, which takes action against such writers, say by keeping them out of the government welfare schemes, impacting their credit profile, so they have difficulty in getting access to loans and things like that. We need to start thinking on those lines. It's not an ideal scenario, no. But then these are the actions that warrant such measures on the part of the government.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is not a time for us to think about along ideological lines, and any attack against health workers who are trying to fight the virus is condemnable 100%. There is no ambiguity in that. And I think all media outlets and everyone needs to come together on that. That's the only way we are going to be able to beat the virus and protect the people from it.